الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى خصوصا على افضلهم وخاتم النبيين محمد الامين وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين اما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كما ورد في سورة التوبة وسورة الصف وسورة الفتح اعوذ باللہ من الشیطان الرجیم بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم هو الذی ارسل رسوله بالہدى ودین الحق لیظہرہ علی الدین کلہ فقال عز وجل كما ورد فی سورة الشورى شرع لکم من الدین ما وصى به نوحا والذی اوحینا الیک وما وصينا به ابراهيم وموسى وعيسى ان اقيموا الدين ولا تتفرقوا فيه وقال عز وجل كما ورد في سورة الانفال وقاتلوهم حتى لا تكون فتنة ويكون الدين كله لله صدق الله العظيم وعن الحارث الاشعري رضي الله تعالى عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم آمركم بخمس الله امرني بهن بالجماعة والسمع والطاعة والهجرة والجهاد في سبيل الله رواه الامام احمد والامام الترمذي رحمهما الله وعن انس رضي الله تعالى عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الجهاد ماذن مزباسنی اللہ الہ یقاتل آخر هذه الامت الدجال رواہ الامام ابو داود رحمہ اللہ رب اشرح لی صدری ویسر لی امری وحلل عقدۃ من لسانی یفقہ قولی اللہم ربنا الہمنا رشدنا وعزنا من شرور انفسنا اللہم ارنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعہ وارنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابہ اللهم وفقنا لما تحب وترضى اللهم وفقنا ان نجاهد في سبيلك باموالنا وانفسنا اللهم ارزقنا شهادة في سبيلك آمين يا رب العالمين Dear brothers and sisters and sons and daughters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. In the previous session, we discussed about jihad fi sabilillah. Let us review briefly the topics regarding this discussion which we have already completed. First of all, the importance of jihad fi sabilillah. Ayat 10 and 11 of Surah As-Saff clearly give us that one cannot hope salvation in the hereafter without jihad fi sabilillah. Then ayat number 14 and 15 of Surah Al-Hujurat clearly give us that jihad fi sabilillah is an integral part of iman itself. Then we discussed two great misconceptions about jihad. Number one, that jihad means war. While we know that in the Quran we have a definite and separate term for war, for the cause of Allah, and that is qital fi sabilillah. Qital is khas, jihad is am. Qital is definitely jihad, but every jihad is not qital. Jihad is a broad-based concept, while qital is a particular thing. But the biggest result, you know, that has been that jihad disappeared from our concept of faraid. It became, you know, when we thought that jihad is war, and war is not going on all the time. So it becomes only fardh kifaya. That is the loss that we have sustained due to this misconception. Number two, we have been thinking that when a Muslim goes to war, he is making jihad fi sabilillah. He might be a fasiq and fajir and zalim. He might be a despotic king. He might be going to war only to increase his revenue, to increase his luxuries. Well, every war that a Muslim is fighting is not necessarily jihad fi sabilillah. This has given bad name to this most sacred term of our deen, that is jihad fi sabilillah. Then we discuss the literal meanings of the word jihad. It is derived from juhud. Juhud means to strive for something. But when juhud comes against juhud, there is a confrontation between two juhuds. It becomes jihad or mujahada. Just as if unilaterally a person kills the other, it is qatl. When there are two groups pitched against each other, each one intending to kill the other, it becomes qital or muqatala. So this is the relationship between juhud and jihad or mujahada. Then we try to understand three levels of jihad in general terms. First of all, every living being is always making jihad, and that is jihad for existence, struggle for existence. Because in this world you have competition everywhere. You have to compete to support yourself. So that competition is everywhere. This is jihad lil hayah, jihad lil baqa, struggle for existence. Number two, every self-respecting human being makes two jihads. The jihad to snatch his rights from the usurpers. His rights, if they have been snatched and usurped by others, his freedom, his right of self-rule or self-determination. So, they have to make jihad. And there is, you know, jihadul hurriyah, the freedom struggle. To get freedom, self-rule, self-determination. Actually, and this can go to even the level of qital, war of independence. So these two levels are common to all human beings. Muslims also can do it, and the non-Muslims also do it. But you know, a Muslim, if he is making these two jihads, but he is, you know, observing the rules of the Sharia, he is not using any forbidden means. Haram means he is only resorting to whatever is halal. Halal means then you know it is a part of the ibadah, and he will be rewarded for both of these jihads also. As the Prophet said, Al-Kasibu Habibullah. And you know, the Prophet said, Man qutila duna malihi fahuwa shaheedun. So if a Muslim is making these two jihads, the jihad for existence, the jihad for hurriyah, and if he is lays down his life, he gets a shahada, a level of shahada. But you know, there are levels, different levels of shahada. The highest level of shahada is when a Muslim lays down his life for the cause of making the deen of Allah supreme. That is the highest level of shahada. Then I told you, the third level is ideological jihad. Every human being has some philosophy, some ideology, consciously or unconsciously. And this ideology gives him a goal in life, an ideal, a nasb al-ayn, adrash in Hindi. So that cause that he has before him, that goal which he has before him, he strives for it. And then there is confrontation, opposing forces, there are obstacles. So he has to make jihad. So every human being makes ideological jihad also. Now what is this jihad? Here you have to use additional words to denote the cause that he has before him, the ideal that he has before him, the ideology that he is subscribing to. That you denote by the word fi sabil. Jihad fi sabil shirk, jihad fi sabil al-watan, jihad fi sabil al-qawm, jihad fi sabil al-ishtirakiya, jihad fi sabil al-demokratiya, jihad fi sabil al-shaytan, jihad fi sabil al-taghut. These words, you know, fi sabil al-taghut, I gave you in the ayah 76 of Surah An-Nisa. This is the word used. And you know, those parents who were compelling their sons and daughters to return to the folds of shirk and kufr, and you know, give up the company of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were also making jihad fi sabil al-shirk. وَإِن جَاهَدَاكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تُشْرِكَ بِمَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ فَلَا تَتْرُهُمَا. So these things, you know, we must understand. Then you, this jihad is to be made with something. Bil mal, that is denoted by ba in Arabic. Jihad bil mal, jihad bil nafs, jihad bil qalb, jihad bil lisan, jihad bil qalam, jihad bil yad, jihad bil Quran, jihad bil saif. So all these terminologies we can have with this jihad. Now you know the fourth point. Now we come particularly the ideological warfare based on iman is jihad fi sabilillah. What is the objective? What's the goal? The goal is to make the deen of Allah supreme. لِيُزْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ, which was the purpose of the advent of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why he was sent? هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُزْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ. At three places, as I have told you know in the beginning, in Surah Al-Saf, in Surah Al-Tawbah, in Surah Al-Fath, these words appear without any difference of a jot or a dot. هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُزْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ. Then you know, ayah number 13 of Surah Ash-Shura, that tells us that this was the purpose, this was the commandment given to all the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all the messengers. شَرَعَ لَكُم مِّنَ الدِّينِ مَا وَصَّى بِهِ نُوحًا وَالَّذِي أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ وَمَا وَصَّيْنَا بِهِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَمُوسَى وَعِيسَى أَنْ أَقِيمُوا الدِّينَ وَلَا تَتَفَرَّقُوا فِيهِ. You have to establish our deen. You have to strive for it. You have to make jihad for it. So we may call to establish the deen of Allah on earth. We may call to establish the kingdom of heaven on earth. We may call, we may name it to establish the system of caliphate on earth. This is only the difference in words. Actually, the meaning is the same. Now, in generalized terms, we should understand three levels of this jihad also. If you have an ideology, and if you are a healthy person, not having a diseased psychology, a normal psychology, normal person, healthy person, he must himself practice his ideology. He shouldn't profess something else and practice something else. That is what is, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned in the beginning of Surah Al-Saf. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu lima taquluna ma la taf'alun. Kabura maqtan inda Allahi an taqulu ma la taf'alun. Why are you saying what you don't practice? This saying and professing and claiming what you are not practicing, it is not going to give you any credit in the hereafter. Rather, it is a great thing to annoy Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It, you know, increases his ghadab like anything. So you must conform to your ideology. You must be a model, practical model of your ideology yourself. Then the second step is, in a normal and healthy psychology person, he must propagate his ideology. He must call people. I quoted the hadith yesterday that the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. None of you can be a mu'min in the real sense of the word unless he likes for others, his brothers, the same thing which he has liked for himself. If you have adopted for yourself the attitude of Iman and Islam, you must like this for your brothers, for your friends, for your relatives, for your kith and kin. You must propagate it. So that is the second, you know, necessary thing to be done at the ideological level. And the final, the third, the highest is that you must establish that ideology as a living politico-socio-economic system. That is the duty of a person who believes in ideology. If somebody believes in Marxism and he is living comfortably in a capitalistic society, what do you say? He is a hypocrite. He doesn't believe in Marxism. It's only lip service that he is doing to the Marxist theory. Actually, he doesn't believe in it. What's the proof of his belief? He should be striving, you know, to topple over this capitalistic system and establish the system of Marxism and communism. That is the proof of his sincerity, his truth. So the same is true here also. If you believe in the deen of Allah, it's your duty, logical duty, that you have to strive and you have to make jihad to establish that deen as a living, real, politico-socio-economic system. So these are the three levels. Now we discuss the first level. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ. یا ایھا الذین آمنوا ادخلوا فی السلم کافہ، یا ایھا الناس اعبدوا ربکم الذی خلقکم، بی اے بونڈز مین ٹو اللہ، یو نو ٹو انٹر اسلام بٹ انٹر ان ٹوٹیلیٹی ناٹ پارشلی، اینڈ یو شوڈ ہیو تقوی آف اللہ ایز ہز رائٹ آف تقوی. سو دیز یونیورسز آف دا قرآن، دیز آیات، دے آر سفیشینٹ، یو نو. اینڈ آئی ٹولڈ یو ایوری پرسن، ایوری مسلم، ایوری مومن ہیز ٹو میک تھری جہادز ٹو بی اے ریئل مسلم، پریکٹسنگ مسلم. جہاد اگینسٹ ہز اون سیلف، ہز اڈ اور لیبیڈو. جہاد اگینسٹ شیطان، قرآن سیز ان الشیطان لکم عدوون فاتخذوہ عدوا، شیطان از اینمی ٹو یو، سو یو ٹیک ہم ایز یور اینمی، ڈونٹ میک فرینڈ ود ہم، ڈونٹ تھنک دیٹ ہی ول گیو یو سم گڈ ایڈوائس. یو نو یوسوسو فی صدور الناس، ہی ول آلویز ایکسائٹ یور اینیمل انسٹنکٹس، یور اڈ اینڈ لیبیڈو. سو یو ہیو ٹو فائٹ آؤٹ اگینسٹ شیطان اینڈ ہز ڈسائپلز آلسو. اینڈ نمبر تھری، you have to resist the pressures of this society, social pressure of a perverted society. So three aspects of jihad at the first level. Then we come to the second level, and that is the ideological warfare. If you believe in iman, there are people who believe in kufr. If you believe in tawheed, there are people who believe in shirk. If you believe in Islam, there are people who think that the communist theory is more correct and the socialist system is more justful and just. So there are ideologies. You are not in a vacuum. So you have to resist. You have to fight out at the ideological level. And that is, you have to propagate your ideology. You have to propagate and convey the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the humanity. You have to call the people to the path of Allah. So these two words, please note: Dawah and Tabligh. What is Tabligh? In Tabligh, you reach out to the people to convey to them the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in Dawah, you call them to the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So actually, Tabligh and Dawah, they are the two sides of the same process. You reach out to convey the message, it is Tabligh. You call them, bring them to the fold of Islam, to the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Udu ila sabili rabbika bil hikmah wal mawizatil hasana wajadilu billati ahsan. Now here, as I told you, because people have their own ideologies, so there is going to be a confrontation between the ideologies. And this is the second level of jihad fi sabilillah. And you know, this has again three sub-levels. At the top is bil hikmah. In every society, there are some people who are intellectuals. They won't listen to sermons. They want arguments. They have their own ideologies, their own thought. It must be proved to them that their ideologies are false. Their thinking is wrong. Their ideas are not sound. You have to prove it. So actually, with Dalil, with Hikmah, with Burhan, Quran, you know, invites and calls the others. You prove your point. If you have any burhan, come with it, come forward with it. قُلْ هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. If you demand burhan from others, others have also the right to demand burhan from you. So the highest level of tabligh and dawah is at the intellectual level. You must have sound arguments, and you must be able to communicate at the highest intellectual level of this society. Unless you can, you have the same, you know, frequency, and you are speaking at the same level, you will not be able to communicate to the intelligentsia, to the intellectuals in that society. And unless the intelligentsia or the intellectuals or the brain trust of a society is converted to iman, the society as a whole will never be converted. You will be able to convert individuals only through sermon, but unless you convert the brain trust of that society, the think tank of that society, the intellectuals of that society, you won't be able to convert the society, to change the society as a whole. And if you want to establish the deen of Allah, you have to change the society, the social order as a whole. Let me give here an example, a simile. You know, in human body, weighing, you know, how many kilograms, you know, 100 kilograms and so on, but there is brain here. Very small thing. maybe 1 kilogram, that's all. But it is controlling the body. Your hands can hold something. Your feet can take you to some place, your legs. But where to go, where not to go is decided here. Which thing should be held and which should not be touched? It is snake, don't touch it. No, it's wood, you can have it. The decision is made here, not by the hands. So these organs, the whole of the body is controlled from here. In the same way, human society behaves as a living organism. It has its own arms and legs and feet and hands, but it has its brain. That we call the brain trust of the society. And unless you convert that brain trust of the society to iman, to your ideology, the society as a whole will not be converted. So that is the importance. That is why Quran is mentioned at the top, قُدْوَ إِلَىٰ سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ بِالْحِكْمَةِ. And the second level is وَالْمَوْعِظَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ. Common people, masses, you know, because they don't have any philosophies in their minds. So they are like clean slates. You can write anything on them. But if there is something written already, you have to wipe it out. So in those intellectuals' minds, something is already ingrained. You have to remove it, and then only you will be able to write something. But in common people, al-mawizatul hasana, udu ila sabil rabbika bil hikmati wal mawizatil hasana, good sermon. You know, there is a saying in Persian, az dil khizat bar dil rezat. If something is coming from your heart, it will reach the heart of the person to whom you are talking. But provided there are no mental barriers in between you. If there are mental barriers, if he has some philosophies, then you have to pierce those barriers to reach his heart. And that is, you know, what I discussed, that the highest level is with hikmah. But where there are no barriers, it's like a clean slate. Only sincerity is needed. And the second thing which is needed is, you must be practicing what you are preaching. These two conditions, if you fulfill, common people, masses, they will accept the advice. This is called Mu'izzatul Hasana. Good advice, good sermon, good vaaz. And the third level is, you have to fight out and confront in argument those who are misleading the people. The Munazara and Mujadala, Jadilum Billati Ahsan. There are Christian missionaries trained for this work. There are Qadiani missionaries. They are trained, special training is given to them. And a common Muslim cannot argue with them. Even an am alim, you know, a common alim, he cannot argue with a Qadiani Muballigh, because he has been trained specially, given special instructions. So you have to fight them out at their own level. You have to meet them in their own elements. And that is Mujadala or Munazara. But the word in Quran is only Mujadala, not Munazara. Commonly we use the word Munazara. This is also required. Just as Shaykh Ahmad Didad is doing with the Christians. You know, in the same way, people have been confronting the Arya Samajis in India. And there was a time, you know, the Arya Samajis were sweeping. And unless there were some Muslims who could, you know, argue with them and defeat them in Munazara, it might have happened that many Muslims would have converted to Hinduism. And there was the threat, you must be knowing, that, you know, in the last century, the last part of the 19th century, when we became slaves to the Britishers, then, you know, there was a raid, ideological raid, of the Christian missionaries. And there was one, Father Fender. He started, you know, doing Munazara with the ulama of Islam from Calcutta. He reached Delhi. In every town, he defeated all the ulama. Because the ulama were not prepared for Munazara. The ulama had never studied Bible. And he had studied Quran thoroughly. So, they were very unequal. Then, you know, standing on the stairs of the Jame Masjid of Delhi, he declared an open declaration, an open ultimatum to any alim throughout India. Let him come and confront me in Munazara. No, it was a very critical moment. Had there been no person to confront him and defeat him, what would have happened? The general masses, Muslim masses, you know, they would have thought, we are defeated. We are defeated physically also we have become slaves, and we have been defeated religiously also because our ulama couldn't confront this person. But you know, there is a very beautiful couplet from Allama Iqbal, khoon e israel aa jata hai aakhir josh mein tod deta hai koi musa talism mein samri. You know, then Maulana Rahmatullah from Kairana of district Muzaffar Nagar of UP, Rahmatullah Kairanvi Rahmatullah alayh, he made munazara with him and defeated him like anything because he had studied Bible thoroughly. So actually you need special training to be able to confront these people who mislead your masses. So this, now for this purpose, how can you do this job unless you don't know your iman, your Islam? You only know certain things, you know, that's all. How can you confront? How can you make dawah? First, you have to learn Islam. You have to have a deep understanding of Islam yourself. And then only you can make dawah, you can make tabligh, and you can call people to the path of Allah. That is why, you know, the Quran says, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, ordered the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to proclaim, قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُو إِلَى اللَّهِ عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ أَنَا وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَنِي. Proclaim, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is my path and I am calling towards Allah having a deep insight myself. I am not calling them blindly. I have the insight, and not only I have the insight, those people who are following me, وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَنِي, they have also the deep insight into what they have accepted, into what they are calling other peoples to. Then that is why, you know, the Prophet said, خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَهُ. The best amongst you are those who learn Quran, understand Quran, who dive deep into the meanings of the Quran. أَفَلَا يَتَدَّبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. And then they teach and propagate and convey not only the message of Quran, but the wisdom of Quran, the hikmah of Quran. وَمَنْ يُوتَ الْحِكْمَةَ فَقَدْ أُوتِيَ خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا. The best good in this world that can be given to any person is the hikmah, the understanding, the tafaqquh. That is why the Prophet said, khayarukum fil jahiliyyati khayarukum fil islam idha faqahu. The best amongst you before Islam are the best amongst you now after iman also. But if they have the tafaqquh, the deep understanding, the insight into what is Islam, what is iman, what are the principles underlying sharia, how is it interrelated logically? This is a whole system, organic whole. Unless you have that deep understanding, how can you convey the message? How can you call people, especially intellectuals, those who have their own ideologies? You can't call them. And let me in the end quote a hadith. The Prophet said, "Man jaahu al-maut wa huwa yatlubu al-ilma." لِيُحْيَيَ بِهِ الْإِسْلَامَ فَبَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ النَّبِيِّينَ دَرَجَةٌ وَاحِدَةٌ فِي الْجَنَّةِ. It is included in the Mishkat, Mishkat al-Masabih, Kitab al-Ilm, the third, you know, chapter of Kitab al-Ilm. This hadith is given there. To whosoever, whomsoever death comes in a state, in a condition that he was still learning deen, he was getting knowledge, but the sole purpose before him for getting this knowledge, for all this learning, was to revive Islam. لِيُحْيَيَ بِهِ الْإِسْلَامِ إِحْيَا أَحْيَا يُحْيِي إِحْيَاً. To revive Islam, that was the sole goal before him, sole aim before him. That was his aim, objective. He wants to work for the revival of Islam. For the revival of Islam, he has to teach Islam. He has to convey Islam. He has to convey the message of Allah at those three levels. At the level of hikmah, at the level of ma'iza, at the level of jidal al-hasana. So he must have knowledge and understanding himself. So he's doing it. And he is still doing it. And that comes. He has not finished. He has not started his mission. And the death has come to him. The Prophet said, فَبَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ النَّبِيِّينَ دَرَجَةٌ وَاحِدَةٌ فِي الْجَنَّةِ. In Jannah, in paradise, there will be only difference of one level between him and the Prophets of Allah عليهم الصلاة والسلام. أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم, Now this is the second level of jihad, and you have to spend money, you have to spend time, energies to understand, to get the knowledge, to get the deep insight, the deep understanding, so that you can convey the message of Allah, you can make tabligh, and you can call people to the path of Allah. Now we come to the third and the highest level. This is the highest level, and that is an aqimud deen. Establish this deen as a living reality, as an organic whole, as a total political socio-economic system. You have to establish it. يَكُونَ الدِّينُ كُلُّهُ لِلَّهِ قَاتِلُوهُمْ حَتَّى لَا تَكُونَ فِتْنَةٌ وَيَكُونَ الدِّينُ كُلُّهُ لِلَّهِ. Now go to war against them. Fight them out, so that till such time that the fitna, the revolt, the fasad is crushed. Because whosoever is claiming sovereignty for himself, he is in rebellion against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sovereignty belongs to him alone. Whosoever claims sovereignty for himself or his nation, he is, you know, in rebellion, he is in revolt against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And those who are faithful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they have to crush this revolt and this rebellion. فَقَاتِلُوهُمْ حَتَّى لَا تَكُونَ فِتْنَةٌ, so that this fitna is finished. وَيَكُونَ الدِّينُ كُلُّهُ لِلَّهِ, and the deen totally comes under Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No aspect of the system of life is outside the pale of the deen of Allah. It's not, you know, it is not that it is controlled by the injunctions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This we have discussed, you know, fully. Because for this you need a revolution. To establish a system, you have to root out the system that is existing before. Unless you can uproot that system, how can you establish another system? There can be no two systems at one place at one time. There cannot be monarchy and democracy. Except, you know, the Britishers, because they are retaining their king or queen just as symbols, nothing else. It's democracy, not monarchy. Same is the case with the Japanese king. But you know, monarchy, imperialism and democracy can't coexist. Capitalism and communism or socialism can't coexist. So you have to uproot the system which is existing before, and then only you can establish a system which you like, which you think is the only just order, social order. So for that you need a revolution. And we have, as you seen, we have discussed, you know, 3 hours we took to understand this process of revolution, how Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam accomplished that miraculous feat, you know, to establish the deen of Allah and to bring about the total, most profound revolution of human history within 20 years. We have studied it. And here let me add, and just to remind you, that now at the final level of jihad you have passive resistance, because now it's the confrontation of force and taqa. You must use force. You must use quwwah. Aiddu lahum mastata'tum min quwwatin wa ribatil khayl. For that you will have to gather strength and force and power. That is, you have to do. So actually, then, till such time that you are strong enough to strike at the roots of that system, to challenge it, and to advance against it, and to, so to say, to have a direct action against it, till such time you have to do passive resistance. Take all persecution, whether verbal or physical, without any retaliation. Then you challenge the system when you feel you are strong enough. You can risk an open confrontation, a head-on collision, then you challenge the system directly. That's the direct action. And then, if there is armed conflict, you risk your life and you come in the field, and that is now qital. Now you see, I discussed 3 levels. And at every level we have either 3 aspects or 3 levels. So multiply 3 by 3. So this is a 9-storied building. Jihad against your own nafs. Jihad against shaitan, jihad against the social pressures of the society. 3, then only you can become a real Muslim, a real bondsman to Allah. Dawah and tabligh at the level of hikmah, دعوی تبلیغ ایٹ دی لیول آف موعظہ، دعوی تبلیغ ایٹ دی لیول آف جدال، دین اونلی یو کین پروپیگیٹ یور آئیڈیالوجی. دین ایٹ دی تھرڈ لیول پیسو ریزسٹنس، ہیو صبر. اسمرو یا علی یاسر فإن موعدکم الجنہ. فار 12 لانگ ایئرس ایٹ مکہ دیر واز نو پرمیشن ٹو ریٹیلیٹ. دین ایکٹیو ریزسٹنس، پیسو ریزسٹنس فرسٹ دین ایکٹیو ریزسٹنس، چیلنج دیم. And then at the ninth level it was armed conflict. So eight stories of this nine storied building are jihad, and the ninth and the topmost story becomes qital fi sabilillah. This qital, as I told you, started in the second year after hijrah, beginning with the battle of Badr, and as far as the Arabian Peninsula is concerned, it ended in the ninth year after hijrah. It's a 6 or 7 years long war with different battles and with a small pause due to the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. So that is armed conflict, that is qital. Eight stories are jihad fi sabilillah, and the ninth one, the topmost one, is qital fi sabilillah. Now about this qital fi sabilillah, you know, there has been a person in Indo-Pakistan subcontinent, and I didn't want even to mention his name, Ghulam Ahmad Qadiani. The Qadianis follow him, and they, some of them accept him as Nabi and some others accept him as Mujaddid. And thank God that we in Pakistan at the highest constitutional level decided that they are outside the pale of Islam. But what he said, deen ke liye haram hai ab dosto qital. He declared qital is now finished. Now qital has been forbidden. Qital is, you know, out of context. And you have only to make jihad, jihad through lisan, jihad through qalam, jihad, you know, through qalb. And this qital, jihad bisayf, is abrogated. But it's absolutely wrong. But I want to mention here that most of us also do think in the same way. If you search your hearts, bottoms of your hearts, we think that only tabligh can do it, only unisarman will serve the purpose. Why? The war was only for defense. There was, you know, no initiative was there from the side of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I have given my views in detail. The initiative was taken by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam after hijrah. He advanced towards Makkah, and he, you know, started sending small groups challenging the Quraysh and, you know, isolating them politically and blockading their, you know, lifeline, blockade of Makkah. So actually this qital, I have narrated the hadith, you know, from Hazrat Anas radiyallahu ta'ala an, and it has been included by Imam Abu Dawood rahimahullah fi his in his Sunan, you know, and that is al-jihadu mazin مزباسنی اللہ الا یقاتل آخر هذه الامۃ الدجال. جہاد, and here he means by jihad qital, because later on he uses the word qital. This will continue from the day Allah sent me to the times when the last part of my ummah will go to war against Dajjal. And that last time when I came here and I gave a lecture, that time is not very far off. That lecture of mine, a videotape was prepared, that is available here. The turmoil in the Muslim Ummah, the things are going in that direction very fast. The appearance of Dajjal is not very far off now. And actually the Al-Malahim, there are full chapters, Kitabul Malahim, in the books of Ahadith. And there is the news and prophecy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, al-malhamatul uzma, the biggest war that will be fought between the Muslims on one side and the Christians, 80,000 of them, 80 banners of Christians, under every banner 12,000. So that will be the number of the people from the Christian side, and the Jews will later on join them under the leadership of Dajjal. All these news are there in the books of Ahadith, in the prophecies of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. سو قتال از کنٹینیوس پروسیس بٹ قتال فی سبیل اللہ. یو نو اف اے مسلم کنٹری از اٹیکڈ بائی این اینمی اینڈ یو آر فائٹنگ فار ڈیفنس دیٹس اے ڈفرنٹ اسٹوری. دیر جہاد الحریہ اینڈ دیر جہاد الحریہ فار ایوری مسلم اٹ از پرمیٹڈ. اونلی وٹ از ریکوائرڈ اٹ دیٹ یو ڈونٹ یوز اینی حرام مینس. You resort to only halal methods, halal means. That's the only thing. But qital fi sabilillah, for that you must pass through this process. This process of jihad bin nafs, jihadun nafs. You have to establish the deen of Allah on your own self and in the sphere of your authority, in your families, in your houses, in your homes. Then you have to make dawah. Then you have to have an organization. And that organization should be disciplined. And then only you can resort to the war for the cause of Allah. Passing through these 8 stages, then qital fi sabilillah, if it comes, then it is fruitful. It brings about results as we see in the seerah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, I have to give a few points more. Number one, at the first 2 levels of jihad, jihad against your nafs, jihad against shaitan, and then jihad at the level of ideological warfare, dawah and tabligh. The tool of this jihad, the weapon of this jihad, is Quran and Quran only. At both these levels, you can fight your own nafs, not with a sword, not with a dagger, not with a pistol. How to fight with your own nafs? How to fight the shaitan? You have only the only sword with which you can kill your nafs, you can kill shaitan, that is Quran. And the method of preaching, I told you, inzar bil Quran, tabshir bil Quran, tazkir bil Quran, tabligh of Quran. I have quoted the ayah so many times. اُوحِيَ إِلَيَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ لِأُنْذِرَكُمْ بِهِ وَمَنْ بَلَغَ فَإِنَّمَا يَسَّرْنَاهُ بِلِسَانِكَ لِتُبَشِّرَ بِهِ الْمُتَّقِينَ وَتُنْذِرَ بِهِ قَوْمًا لُدًّا فَذَكِّرْ بِالْقُرْآنِ مَنْ يَخَافُ وَعِيدُ وَمِنَ اللَّيْلِ فَتَهَجَّدْ بِهِ نَافِلَةً لَكَ. And you know, this word tabligh, you know, occurs only in Quran at one place. يَا أَيُّهَا الرَّسُولُ بَلِّغْ مَا أُنْزِلَ إِلَيْكَ مِنْ رَبِّكَ. What has been sent down to you, you have to convey this. That is why I told you, he never made lengthy sermons. Wherever he went for dawah and tabligh, he narrated and he recited the ayat of Quran. Yatlu alayhim ayati. So actually, this is the sword, this is the weapon, this is the tool. And I quoted in the previous session the ayah from Surah Al-Furqan, فَلَا تُطِعِ الْكَافِرِينَ وَجَاهِدْهُمْ بِهِ جِهَادًا كَبِيرًا. For 12 long years, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was making jihad with Quran. There was no sword in his hand. What about, what to speak of sword? He forbade his followers even raising their own hands for self-defense. What to speak of swords and weapons? So at these 2 levels, you may call it the tool of jihad, the weapon of jihad, the means of jihad, at these 2 levels is sirf Quran, only Quran. And let me quote here 2 couplets of Allama Iqbal. And in these 2 couplets, they are in Persian. Iqbal has given us the meanings of 2 ahadith. Let me quote the ahadith first. The one hadith, the Prophet said, and I, you know, referred to it in the previous session, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ يَجْرِي مِنَ الْإِنسَانِ مَجْرَ الدَّمْ. This shaitan, this iblis, this permeates and circulates throughout the body of a man just like the blood. One hadith. The other hadith I quoted in some other of my lectures. The Prophet said, with every human being there is a shaitan. Some sahabi, we should be thankful to him, he took the courage of asking him directly, do you also have a shaitan with you? The answer was yes, but I have subjugated him, subdued him. He obeys me. Now these are the 2 ahadith. And now listen to the Persian couplets. Kushtane Iblis kare mushkil ast. To kill and slay Iblis is very difficult. Why? Zaan ke u gum andar amake dil ast. Because it is circulating in the human body. How can you kill it? You need some penicillin. You need some medicine which can circulate through the body to be, you know, an antidote for this poison of Iblis which is circulating in the whole body. Kushtane Iblis kare mushkil ast. It's a difficult job. Zaan ke u gum andar amake dil ast. It is there in the depths of your heart. Khushtar aan bashad musalmanash kuni. It is better that you make your Iblis Muslim. Make him surrender. Khushtar aan bashad musalmanash kuni. Kushtae shamshire quranash kuni. You can kill it with the sword of Quran. So actually at these two levels, jihad against your nafs, jihad against wrong ideologies, the only weapon, the only tool is Quran. But at the highest level now, you need quwwah. Aiddu lahum mastata'tum min quwwatin wa ribatil khayl. You have to gather strength. First of all, human potential, piety, composed of dedicated, committed people who are ready to lay down their lives, who are ready to slay, to sacrifice everything that they have, all their belongings. That is the quwwa. And then, you know, weapons you must have. You must have all faith and confidence in Allah. But you have to gather all the strength that you can. Never, you know, whatever you can, you have to do it. Never think that Allah will do it for you. Do whatever you can, what is in your within your power. You do it. And then you should have confidence in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not before that. Now, the final point is organization. At these three levels, different types of organizations can do the job. Now, coming from down upwards, this jihad against the nafs, this is essentially and basically an individual phenomenon. I can't fight against your jihad, against your nafs, and you can't fight against my nafs. I have to fight it out myself. I have to fight out my shaitan myself. It is with me. So actually, this first jihad is essentially, basically, it's an individual phenomenon. Every individual has to make it. But you know, here also, company, suhbah, Maiya, if you are together, if you are in the form of group, you have also decided that I will live as a Muslim, die as a Muslim. I also decide, I will live as a Muslim, die as a Muslim. You also decide, I am ready to sacrifice everything for the cause of Allah. I also decide the same. Now, if we are together, if we have company of each other, if we keep company of those people who are devoted and who have that real iman, then you know you will get help from this company. That is ma'iyah, that is sohba. And that is, you know, in Surah At-Tawbah, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu taqullah wa koonu ma'as sadiqeen. O you who believe, you should yourself have the taqwa of Allah and be with those who are true in their faith, who are true in their actions. You should keep their company. You should be with them. So it will be helpful, because you know, to do this jihad alone, although you have to do it alone, it is individual phenomenon, but you will get help from the company of like-minded people who have the same goal, who have the same aims and objects in life. But no formal organization is necessary. Although in our history we find that there is the institution of bay'ah at this level also. This we call bay'atul irshad. If you feel this person is a knowledgeable person, he knows the path of Allah, and he is a sincere person, he is not, you know, having his own axes to grind, and he has no his personal ambitions, he is a sincere person. You attach yourself to him. This is irshad, murshid and mustarshid. One who is showing the path. Irshad means showing the path, to guide. He is a guide. You go somewhere, you know, to see some new city, the new place, as a tourist, You have guides there because they know. You take the lead of you avail of their guidance. So in the same way, there can be guides in the spiritual, you know, level, at the level of the path of Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala. They are called murshids, and those who attach themselves with them, they are called mustarshids, who want guidance. And for that, Bayatul Irshad has been instituted throughout our history. And there is a basis for that bayah also. Because the bayah, the first bayah of Aqaba in the seerah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which was 1 year before the bayah of Aqaba that I have narrated so many times, that is of Samutah. Before that, 1 year before that, the bayah was Bayatul Aqaba al-Ula. And in that, you know, that what these things were mentioned. They promised, we won't make shirk with Allah. We won't commit theft. We won't commit adultery. And we will not disobey you in whatever good you order us. That is the bayah. And these are the words of Bayatul Nisa fi suratil mumtahina fil Quran. These are words there, you know, because the Prophet was given the guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, rather a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have bayah, take bayah from the Muslim women also. And the wordings of the bayah of women, they are mentioned in Quran. The wordings of the bayah of men is nowhere mentioned in Quran. It is mentioned only in a hadith. I quoted the hadith yesterday. نَحْنُ الَّذِينَ بَايَعُوا مُحَمَّدًا عَلَى الْجِهَادِ مَا بَقِينَا أَبَدًا. The companions were chanting this couplet during the battle of Ahzab. We are those, we have given our bayah to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that we shall continue fighting till death. So long as we are living, we will continue making jihad. نَحْنُ الَّذِينَ بَايَعُوا مُحَمَّدًا عَلَى الْجِهَادِ مَا بَقِينَا أَبَدًا. And there are the wordings, بَايَعْنَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ عَلَى السَّمْعِ وَالطَّاعَةِ. I narrated that hadith many times. It's a lengthy hadith. But these wordings we find only in the hadith. But the wordings of the bayah of women we find in the Quran, in Suratul Mumtahina. So that is, you know, the organization at the first level. What about the organization at the second level? You have to convey message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to convey the wisdom of Quran. You have to teach and preach Islam. For that, institutions will do. A party is not necessary. Party is something else. Institutions, associations, you can have associations, publishing houses, you can have, you know, because in these days you should have some telecommunication, you know, if the means you can have, you should try to avail them. So for that, organizational basis can be loose organizations, associations, not that bayah samutah fil maruf, not that disciplined organization. At this level, you need associations. You need institutions. They will do. Because, you know, these all institutions, these madaris, you know, Darul Uloom, they have been established. Why? To disseminate the knowledge of the word of Allah and the sayings of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Qala Allah wa qala Rasul. Going on in all the Darul Ulooms. So actually institutions, associations, and what we call in Urdu anjumans, these can work at the second level. But at the third and the highest level, to establish the deen of Allah as a politico-socio-economic system, to make it supreme, لَيُزْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ, to bring about that position, يَكُونَ الدِّينُ كُلُّهُ لِلَّهِ. Well, that, at that level, it is inevitable that you should have a disciplined party. And that party should have the discipline of the army, the proverbial discipline of listening and obeying, fully disciplined. And for that, I have given you the bayah, that is from Hazrat Ubadah ibn Samit radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, and that is the muttafaqun alayhi hadith. Both Imam Muslim and Imam Bukhari agree on this hadith. And there is no higher level of authenticity of any hadith than this, the muttafaqun alayhi. And that is bayana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ala sam'i wa ta'ati fil usri wal yusri wal manshati wal makrahi وَعَلَىٰ أَسَرَةٍ عَلَيْنَا وَعَلَىٰ لَا نُنَازِلْ أَمْرَ أَهْلَهُ وَعَلَىٰ نَقُولَ بِالْحَقِّ أَيْنَمَا كُنَّا لَا نَخَافُ فِي اللَّهِ لَوْمَةَ الْعَيْنِ. There are additional words in the حدیث وچ از انکلوڈیڈ ان دی صحیح آف مسلم الا ان تروا کفرا بواحا عندکم فیہ من اللہ برہان. یو نو دی اوبیڈینس ٹو محمد صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم واز ٹوٹل. وٹ ایور ہی سیڈ ہی واز معصوم, ہی واز انفالیبل, ہی واز ناٹ سیئنگ اینی تھنگ فرام ہز اون مائنڈ. وما ینطق عن الہوا ان ہوا الا وحی یوحا. بٹ فار نو بڈی ایلس دیٹ اوبیڈینس ہیز ٹو بی فائنل, دیٹ اوبیڈینس از مطلق, دیٹ اوبیڈینس از ایبسولیوٹ. نو, دی اوبیڈینس ٹو اینی ادر پرسن آفٹر محمد صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم, ایون ابو بکر, ایون عمر, ایون عثمان, ایون علی رضی اللہ تعالیٰ عنہ اجمعین, اینڈ فار اینی پرسن آفٹر ہم ٹل دی اینڈ آف دس ورلڈ, دس ول بی کنڈیشنل, دس ول بی لمیٹڈ بائی دی انجنکشن آف دی قرآن. سو وٹ شوڈ یو ڈو؟ یو ہیو گیون بیعہ. سو ایکچولی آئی ٹولڈ یو وی ہیو اسٹیبلشڈ تنظیم اسلامی آن دی بیسس آف دس بیعہ. وی ایڈیڈ اے ورڈ, انی ابایعک علی السمع والطاعۃ فی المعروف within the limits of the Sharia. You can't transgress the limits of the Sharia. It is only the Agha Khanis, the Ismailis, they give their Imam the authority that he can declare anything which is haram according to the Sharia as halal. He can declare anything he likes. So that is actually not the case with the Sunni Islam. It is the Imamiya and especially the Agha Khanis. So in Islam we have some utaat fil maruf within the limits. Now if a person thinks that this is against Islam, he should have a clear proof from illa an tarau kufran bawahan indakum min Allah fihi burhan. If you have a clear proof that this is haram according to the Sharia, then only you can say la sama wa la ta, now we won't obey, we won't listen. If it is not haram, you can't prove it is haram, you have to obey. That is the basis of the organization. That is the basis of Hizbullah, as I told you. That is why today also I narrated the ahadith. Amurukum bi khamsin bil jama'ati wa sam'i wa ta'ati wal hijrati wal jihad fi sabilillah. Then bayana rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam ala sam'i wa ta'ati fil usri wal yusri wal manshati wal makrahi wa ala asaratina alayna وعلى الله نراد الامر اهله الا ان تروا كفرا بواحا عندكم فيه من الله برهان لا نخاف في الله لومه لائم. So I told you yesterday that this is the most comprehensive constitution of any Islamic revolutionary party, any Hizbullah, any party which is established to bring about an Islamic revolution, to establish the system of caliphate. And I also quoted the hadith. It is from Abdullah ibn Umar رضي الله تعالى عنهما, included in the Sahih of Imam Muslim. مَن مَاتَ وَلَيْسَ فِي عُنُقِهِ بَيْعَةٌ مَاتَ مِيتَةً جَاهِلِيَّةً. Whosoever among the Muslim dies in a condition that he doesn't have the chain of bay'ah around his neck, he dies the death not of a Muslim, but of the death of Jahiliyyah. Jahiliyyah was the period before Islam, before the advent of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Clear words, and I can analyze it, because only two conditions are possible. Either there is the system of caliphate, the Islamic state is established, there you have to give bayah to the Khalifatul Muslimin or the Amirul Mu'mineen or whosoever is the caliph. That bayah will be bayah of some uta'a fil ma'ruf will be to him. Or it is not established, then you have to establish it, you have to make jihad to establish it. You have to bring about a revolution to establish it. For that you have to have a party. It cannot be brought about without a party. And then you have to give this bayah to the Amir of that party. So this is the organization which is necessary, inevitable, at the highest, topmost level of the jihad, and that is to establish the Deen of Allah. This is all that I wanted to say about jihad. I wanted to give my comments on jihad of Afghanistan and jihad of Kashmir and jihad of Bosnia, but now time is now up. After this, I will give you briefly my opinions, inshallah. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa li sa'iril muslimin wal muslimat.